Good afternoon. Welcome to the memorial service for Brian Harris. Through the years that I've been in ministry, I've done several memorial services. Some have been more difficult or a bit closer to home than others because of my personal connection with the family or the one who has passed away, and that is the case today. My family and I have had the privilege of knowing Brian, Shelby, and the boys for the past 17 years. They're part of our church family, and I want to say, on behalf of Brenda and I and our church family at Grandview Family Worship, we're sorry for your loss. Sorry for the loss of a husband, a father, a brother, and a friend. As we begin our service this afternoon, I have a couple of passages of scripture that I'd like to read. And I pray that God's word will help bring us comfort and peace during this time. In Psalm 27, verse 1 and 4, it reads, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple." Also, John chapter 14, beginning at verse 1, we find the words of Jesus. And he says this, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me." Would you please join me as we pray? Lord, Heavenly Father, as we gather here today, may the God who grants a peace that surpasses all our understanding be with us today and the days that lie ahead. We pray that your holy presence be felt and the comfort of the Holy Spirit be about us today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. your guiding hand.
That song was chosen by Brian's son, Zach. This time we're going to allow you as a guest, if you have a memory, something that you would like to share about Brian. Anybody here would like to take a moment to share a thought? Well, you're, oh, go ahead. Yep.
Good. How old I am. You have paper with handwritten notes. It's been a few months now since we all lost Brian. And I can recall getting that phone call like it was yesterday. My heart sank. I thought, is this real? The last time I saw Brian was Father's Day, a few months before he passed. My wife, Brenda, and I met Brian, Shelby, and Alex at Dairy Queen here in town. And looking back, I'm so glad that we took that time to do that. I never thought it would be the last time I saw him. It was. I didn't know Brian myself from middle school. We never really knew each other very well until high school. We both were on a freshman basketball team, and I think that's where I first got to know him a little bit better. Everyone on the team liked Brian. Someone on the team came up with a nickname for Brian. It kind of stuck. Some of you know what that is. It was never meant to be anything negative toward Brian, but Brian kind of took it that way, and you know, he never liked it. So anyone that basically wanted to call him that nickname, he would punch you in the arm, put you on the ground if you could. So don't worry, Brian, I won't say what that nickname is. Later in high school is when I really got to know Brian. He started coming to the Days of Harvest youth group, and that was a bond that really started between us. Myself, Scott Johnson, Dave Japon, and Brian spent countless hours together, usually in Scott's parents' basement, playing euchre and buck euchre. I'm thankful for that time. Anyone who knew Brian knows how much he loved playing cards, and he was excellent at it. He and Shelby were pretty much unbeatable as a team. I'll miss those times together playing cards with him immensely. The day I found out Brian had passed, I texted a couple of people that knew Brian, but they hadn't talked or seen Brian since high school. One of them replied, "Oh darn," he used another word I won't repeat. So I'm sorry to hear that. He was a great dude. Thanks for letting me know. And then he sent a follow-up text and said, "This makes me sadder than I would expect, considering I haven't seen him in 30 years. The other person I had texted, who was on that same freshman basketball team with Brian, he called right back. He's someone who hadn't talked to Brian or seen Brian since 1984, but Brian had left that much of an impression that he wanted to call me and talk about Brian with me. We talked for almost an hour. Brian always called me on my birthday. I'm not sure when that started, but he did it for a long time and he never forgot. It was always nice to catch up with him then. The last several years have been very, very tough for Brian, and I'm fortunate enough that God allowed me to be able to take Brian to several, him and Shelby, to doctor appointments in Madison. Shelby would get as far as Cross Plains, but she wasn't about to drive those mean streets of Madison, so I would take him the rest of the way, and I'm so thankful that I was allowed to do that. I can't imagine what he had to deal with these last few years. Those who know Brian might say he's someone whose mind was hard to change once he was set on something. There's another word maybe for that too. Well, that also can be said about his faith in the Lord. He never wavered in that at all. He was rock solid. I never once heard him complain or get mad at God. I believe God's rewarded Brian for his faith, and he's in perfect health right now. Amen. And that's what I think about, how happy he must be in the presence of God, and that I someday will see him again. Love you, Brian.
Anyone else?
Really plan on this, so I don't have paper.
Shelby, I explained the nickname. It was actually a good thing. It was named after a basketball player, I won't say who, but Brian had some awesome moves. Much like Paul, by the way, I'm Scott Johnson, one of the folks that Paul mentioned, and I think I knew Brian back maybe in the nursery of East United Methodist Church. We actually met Paul, so that's a really long time ago. Brian, I can't really add a lot to what Paul said because he did a fabulous job. But I read something the other day, and it talked about followers of Jesus. And how we always think we're going to have this blessed life and everything's going to be perfect. But it's not always perfect. But that's okay. And Brian knew that, and he held firm to his faith. And if you guys remember anything about him, it's his faith in Jesus and how important it was to him, and how he wanted to convey that to other people. And I played a very small role along with Paul and other people and Dave Gillingham and Ron and others in, I guess I'll say, helping raise Brian in his faith. And he just never wavered from it. And I remember him for that. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, I met my wife, because this is why I'm emotional, because I have a beautiful wife of over 30 years. And I was at a concert. My brother is Jamie. And I was this newly graduated college stud, right? And I'm going to see my brother at a concert. And I think my wife, Laura, was there. She and sister, Kim. And Brian walked in. I'm like, yo, you know, come on over. He came over and goes, well, I got this girl, she's a friend of mine from church. Oh, yeah, bring her over. And the rest is history. And I always remember him for that. And I was also thinking how he's looking down from heaven going, this is awesome. All these people are here for me. And I think it's pretty awesome, too. Thank you.
I never pictured Brian as a matchmaker. Anyone else would like to share? Yes.
Just a short thing. He was at our house a couple weeks before he died, and he was also smashing us in Uber. I just remember thinking to myself, he made some comment or some gesture or something. I see God in him. And it really, just really.
Thank you. Anyone else? I have a couple of letters from some sisters that have asked that I would read on their behalf. The first one is from Sister Amy, and these are just some memories and some thoughts that she'd like to share. And it reads, as we were kids, we did a lot of things together. We played basketball together with our mom. We would play horse, play baseball, and I remember hitting the ball and breaking the window, and then we got into trouble. Brian got to play cards with mom and the older ones. We did get to go to some places with mom, like church every Sunday, and to the park. Brian was in charge one time when we were little. We were going to go sledding at the campus. It was Brian, Richard, Amy, Robert, Kim, and Rachel. I remember everyone landed on top of me. And us girls got cold and wanting to go home. Brian got mad at us because we wanted to go, and he told us we were crybabies. And that they weren't ready yet. I remember Brian being in charge of the TV. We always had to watch what he wanted to watch. It was usually MASH, Hogan's Heroes, Fantasy Island, Dukes of Hazzard, Chips, or Gilligan's Island. He also tried to teach our mom how to ride his moped and how to drive his go-kart. We'd get to go to the park, and this one time Brian got hurt because he tried to be a superhero and jump into a tree. From that ride called the Bubble, he was hurt. He hurt his ankle, and we had to carry him home. We also go to the parade and Apple Festival and Viola's Horse and Colt Show and watch the truck pulls, which we did as kids with our parents and we still do with our own kids. So that was one of my last times with them. This last year. And as we did family picnics at Penny and Kenny's, and my most special memory of my brother, Brian, is 21 years ago. It was when our dad passed away. I called Brian at his work, and he told me that dad was passing away. I was the only one at the hospital, and he came. I could see them working on him because the door wasn't shut all the way. When he got there, he gave me the biggest hug ever. You have to understand that hug meant the world to me because we never hugged each other. We cried so hard, and of course, the hospital called the rest of our family, but we were so much better after. And I believe because we did talk more and said love you more than we did in the past. We never said it much, but we just knew we did. Just know, Brian, that you are always with me, and I miss you every day. I love you, brother. Hope you are taking care of mom and dad and the rest of our loved ones up there in heaven. Till I see you again, you will be with all of us. God bless you. Love always and forever your sister, Amy. I have another letter here from a sister. This is Rachel. It says, Dear Brian, where do I begin? Life without you is not the same. You impacted so many people without even realizing. I looked up to you and so many others did too. I loved watching you just set the example of what a husband, father, grandpa, brother, uncle, cousin, and friend should be. You were so fun to hang out with and to talk to. If I needed any advice or had questions about anything, you were always there for me no matter what. I love that you would call me and ask to look up a movie for you because you missed the ending and wanted to know when it was on again? Or do you call just to chat? We always had the best time together talking, laughing, and living the best of life. One of my best memories together was when we brought home a three-wheeler that was hard to steer. You still let me drive it around the backyard. All of a sudden, I was trying to turn, and I couldn't get it to turn, so I drove up the fence, and it fell on top of me. As you came running over to me, you were concerned that I might be hurt until you heard me laughing, so you started to laugh too. It took a little bit to get it off me because we were laughing so hard. One of my fondest memories of you. Another amazing memory was May 13th, 2006, the day I got married. You walked me down the aisle because our parents passing away. You never took their place, but you definitely filled in when needed. Even though you knew lots of photos would be taken, you agreed to do it for me. I was so blessed to be your sister. I love going to all the parades together, Viola Horse Colt Show, Gays Mills Apple Festival, the fireworks. None of our adventures would be the same without you. Tuesday, fun night, church league. Softball will definitely not be the same. For years we have watched you play, or your boys play. It was a tradition that I wasn't ready to give up. I know Shelby, Tara, Miss M, Rainey, and Maddie, myself will go to watch, but you won't be there with us. This is going to be so hard for all of us. I'm not going to lie, it's been rough not having you with us. I miss your phone calls. What are you doing tonight? I miss seeing you in person, always getting a hug goodbye and hearing I love you, sis. Seeing that bond you had with my girls was a blessing. Having you come to Rainy softball games and volleyball, telling her you are proud of her. They love being with you and making memories like I did. I'm really sad that it wasn't longer. You're an amazing example of what an uncle should be with his nieces. We are so blessed to be your family. I know God's timing is perfect, but we weren't ready for you to leave us. And though you were ready, it was time for you to go. You left all of us heartbroken and very sad. I know you would say to me, Rachel, you'll be fine. I'm okay. You need to be strong for the family. You need to still do all of your family traditions. Your heart will be filled with joy again. I don't want you to be sad with me being gone. In time, you'll be able to be whole again. Lean on Jesus. He's giving you hugs for me. Love you, sis. So as we say goodbye to Brian today, remember the love Jesus Christ, that he loved Jesus Christ with all of his heart. He was the best husband to Shelby, the amazing dad to Tyler, Zach, and Alex. He loved his grandkids, Benjamin, Aurora, and Amelia. And he had a genuine heart to give the best advice, the best laughter. Thank you for being the best big brother. Love you always and forever. Your little sis, Rachel. This time we have another song chosen by Brian's son, Tyler.
To heaven at visiting hours, so I could just show up and bring the new questions to the world. And I wish that you met her. The things that you learned from me, I got them all from you. If I just stay around, we'll put all world to rise. The little ones will grow and I'll still drink your favorite wine. And soon they're going to close, but I'll see you another day. So much has changed since you've been situation. I hadn't a clue how I'd even raise them.
heaven at visiting hours, and I would ask them if I could take you home. But I know what they'd say, that it's for the best. So I will live life the way you taught me and make it on my own.
I'm Ron Hintz, the Wesley director of the Days of Harvest Youth Ministry that Ryan played a very big part of. I'm just very glad to have this opportunity to speak here at Brian's memorial service. Thank you, Shelby, for allowing me to share. And thank you all for bearing with me. And my apologies for reading these words. It's not my normal style, but I didn't want to ramble too long. And I wanted to be careful about every word that I speak here at Brian, as I speak of Brian Harris, how I remember him, who he was, and what I learned from him. Brian was my first friend in Richland Center. As a stranger, I moved up into the community here when I was 29 years old to be a part of the Days of Harvest ministry. In those first weeks of being new in town and not really knowing anyone, Brian was the one who would come up to the youth center just across the street from here almost every day after school. We would talk and play ping pong. Typical of Brian's style, we decided we were going to keep track of the games to see who could be the first to win 100. We quit counting when Brian was ahead about 32 to 11. He did teach me how to play ping pong quite well, actually. I remember, though, how much I looked forward to knowing that he was coming up and that he would be dropping by the youth center. As I got to know the others in the group more and spend more time with him, I began to observe the role that Brian had in the youth group. Brian was one of the older ones in the group, also bigger and stronger than the rest. He had the respect of the younger kids. In fact, he was almost a legend, bigger than life. He just had this quality about him. They looked up to him. They seemed to think there was nothing he couldn't do, especially when it came to his strength. They would hang on him, and he would throw them around, usually pretty gently. He was never too good or too old for them. He was their friend also. Perhaps he was a little on the wild side, a little dangerous, but I think that just increased the awe they held him in. He was a de facto leader of the youth group. As I got to know Brian better over the years, I began to appreciate him all the more. I learned an important lesson from him. There were kids in the youth group that were more popular, more polished, respectable, attractive, fit in better, seemed to have more going for them. It was natural to invest time in them, to see that they had great potential for leadership. But actually, Brian became the leader. And then there was Brian. He was a little on the rough side. Didn't fit the world's standards of success. A bit of a nonconformist. He drove a little too fast, and then he got a motorcycle. His hair was a little too long, but he didn't require a lot of attention. And he was always there. He was there for the fun, but he was also there for the work projects that we had. You could always count on Brian. He was faithful. I could always call on him when I needed something, the remodeling projects, fixing my car, cutting up a deer we had hit on the highway. In the summer, when I was asked to return to my old job in Janesville to run the cement crew for my old boss, I accepted the offer only if Brian was also hired and would work with me. We commuted back and forth all that summer and into the fall. He was a hard worker, an eager learner, a great teacher, and always an encourager. It was a great season in both of our lives. Later, Brian agreed to open the youth center two nights a week for several years, freeing me to do other things. He continued to be a good example and friend to a whole new generation of young people. I could go on and on of all the memories of things Brian's did, never a thought of himself, eager to serve and to be a help. Brian was a good friend, the one you can call whenever, even in the middle of the night, and know that he would be there to help. A friend that, as Proverbs says, loves at all times. A friend that sticks closer than a brother. A true friend. Jesus says, greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. Paul goes on to explain that this servant friend, this Jesus one, should be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, with humility of mind regarding one another as more important than yourself, which was always been my short definition of what love is. Remember what Jesus said, greater love has no one than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. I like the way the Apostle Peter approaches the controversial subject of spiritual gifts. He breaks them down just into two simple categories, those who speak and those who serve. We tend to think that those who have the gift to stand up and speak are the more important ones. We certainly give them more attention, give them more value. But Peter says of equal value, and I would say perhaps of even greater value, are those who are called to serve by the strength that God also gives them. Jesus goes on to say, you are my friends if you do what I command you. And this, in his commandments, are to believe in him and to love one another. He says the greatest of all will be the servant of all. Now, I know at this point it sounds like I'm just preaching to all of you, one of those people with the gifts standing up front and talking too long sometimes. But what I'm really trying to do in all of this is I'm just trying to remember Brian, who he was, the example that he set. Brian was and did all of these things that the scriptures were talking about. In the world's eyes, he was not an important person, never lived in a big house, never drove a fancy car, never had a great important position in the community, was never recognized as a great person. But in my eyes, he was one of the greatest among us because he was the servant of all. And that's why I felt compelled to speak today to honor him. He was a true friend that had the servant's heart of God, which has become, in my mind, evidence in the transforming work of the Holy Spirit in his heart. He was a person with a servant's calling who not only served, but did so always with a good attitude, was there to start the job and stayed until it was finished, not quitting when he was tired or when it got discouraging and the end was never in sight. The type that thanks you for letting him help rather than expecting to be thanked for what he did. Truly humble, not perfect, but truly appreciative of all that God had blessed him with. Abraham was called a friend of God. I believe Brian could also be called that. I certainly feel honored that he was a friend of mine. There's much I learned, much we could all learn from Brian's example. Let me end with this to bring this back today. It's something that's just been on my mind lately. When questioned about the reality of the resurrection, the hope of eternal life, which is something we can't even imagine, we who are still tied to this world of time and its physical limitations can't comprehend the resurrection. But Jesus makes this statement. You are mistaken. You do not understand the scriptures, nor the power of God. For God says, I am the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And I believe he would go on and say today, I am also the God of Brian. Brian is not dead. And I do not mean just mean that he lives in our hearts or in our memories or in his legacy that we are honoring today. Brian is alive now. In fact, more alive than any of us are who are here today. He's alive in a new world with new experiences. And Brian is alive, and he is not the Brian of these later years of frailty and infirmities, but the Brian I remember that I first met when I came here to Richmond Center. Bigger than life, a gentle giant, a humble legend. And now he has been welcomed into the presence of God, his Father, hearing these words. Well done, my good and faithful servant, my son. Enter into the joy of your master. Great is your reward. It would do all of us good to consider this today and to live our lives according, remembering Brian's example. So thank you all for letting me speak of Brian, the Brian that I knew, that I remember, that we honor, the Brian that still is alive today. Thank you all.
goes by that I don't see. Live on and on the better parts of you. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I find the sea that you can see.
Service this afternoon, I find myself dwelling on a specific passage of scripture found in Apostle Paul's writing in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 10. It reads, Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heaven, to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who has made for us this very purpose, and have given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are in the home, in the body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and we prefer to be away from the body and home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are home in the body or away from it. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. I chose this passage of scripture for a few different reasons, as I believe it relates to Brian and our lives today. The first reason being that Apostle Paul makes a comparison that our physical body is like that of a tent. Just as a tent provides temporary housing while on a camping trip, our physical bodies provide temporary housing while we are on this earth. Brian's earthly tent existed for 55 years. Those years filled with memories and ceremonies, concerts and sporting events, reunions, family get-togethers, and anniversaries. More specifically, some of those being that Brian enjoyed playing cards with his family on Sunday evening while listening to Those Were the Days on WRCO radio. He also found enjoyment playing church league softball and volleyball, where every once in a while you got a glimpse of Brian's competitive side. He also helped coach Little League Baseball while his boys were playing. Brian always supported his sons in other various activities that they participated in. Somewhere along the way, Brian became a fan of John Wayne. I believe it was Hondo was his favorite movie. And also a fan of the Green Bay Packers. Earlier years when Brian was healthy, worked hard while putting in many hours at the pattern shop, and took pride in providing for his family. Brian also enjoyed working with his hands and repairing something old or building something new. For many years, Brian was a church member at Grandview Family Worship, where he served as a Sunday school teacher on the missions team, and also the last few years as a church advisory board member. Brian was willing to serve and work in any way he could. Another reason I chose this passage of scripture is that Apostle Paul states, "For a while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened." Unfortunately, in 2013, Brian began to experience what would be the beginning of several health issues. Burdened first with a stroke, then a couple years later having a deal with kidney failure that led to having to receive dialysis a few times a week. In time, his tent, his body, began to break down and wear out. his strength not what it used to be. Lastly, I chose this passage of Scripture because it reminds all of us that this tent we currently live in is temporary. Remember the verse, "For while we are in this tent?" As Christians, while we are on this earth, we are in this tent. However, thankfully, joyfully as Christians, we are promised that we'll have new bodies that will be perfect for everlasting life, for all eternity. We, just like Brian, will no longer have need of a temporary tent that will wear out. John in the book of Revelation writes, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning, crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" What an incredible thought and promise that we can exchange this temporary body and life for eternal reward and eternal home in heaven. Because the reality of it is, this tent, this physical body that you and I currently are living in, is wearing out day by day. For Brian, because he placed his faith in Jesus Christ and received the gift of salvation, Brian is the recipient of these promises that John wrote about in the book of Revelation. Brian is no longer in pain. His eyesight is greater than it ever has. He is seeing more splendid and beautiful things now than he ever did. Tears of frustration and discouragement have been wiped away and replaced with joy and peace that you and I can't even understand. So how does one receive this incredible promise of eternal home in heaven? The answer to that question is also found in that passage of Scripture. It's living by faith, not by sight. Somewhere in the journey of Brian's life, he realized the importance and the need to place his faith in Jesus, confessing him as his own and received the gift of salvation that is offered only through Jesus Christ. So let me ask you, like Brian, are you certain that your eternal home is in heaven? Because if not, you can't be certain. I pray the whole world hears. Brian's desire for his family and friends is that they would love the Jesus he came to know and love. A few moments ago, I shared that you could be certain of eternal life. You may be asking, well, how do we do that? Maybe you're here this morning or this afternoon and you've never done that before. See, Jesus Christ paid the price of our sin on the cross. The Bible tells us it's only through Jesus that we come to the Father. Maybe you're here this afternoon and you've been stirred by the things that have been shared and the things that have been said. I want to encourage you and help you with that, that could be the Holy Spirit that's stirring your heart right now. The one thing I so enjoyed about Brian was always straight. He always wanted to hear straight. He didn't want to beat around the bush. So I think Brian would be pleased if I shared this with you, that the only way to heaven is through Jesus Christ. If you would like to see Brian again someday, that avenue is through Jesus Christ. Jesus willingly laid down his life for us so that we can have forgiveness of sin. See, salvation is a gift. It's not something we buy. It's not something we work for. But it's a gift. And as a gift, you receive it freely. Just ask Jesus to become the Lord of your life. You ask God to forgive you of your sin and ask Jesus to become the Lord of your life. And the beauty of it is, after that, you begin to walk the spiritual journey to get to know Jesus and our Heavenly Father. And I would encourage you today, if you've never done that, there's no better day. There's no better moment. You don't have to do it in front of anyone. It doesn't have to be in the congregation. It'll be a very personal moment. You just get alone with God. I said, well, I don't even know how to pray. Prayer is talking, it's communicating. Just communicate with the Father in heaven where your heart is. You need to ask for forgiveness and receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. That was Brian's desire for his family. That they would love the Jesus that he got to know. I also have a few personal comments or thoughts that I would like to share. What Brian has meant to me personally and to our family. Brian has always been or always was very welcoming to myself, my family. He's always asking about my three boys. Not just when they're young, but even as adults, he would always ask, how are the boys doing? What are they up to? What's going on in their life? He was always concerned. Now, I've had conversations with Brian through the last few years. There were times that he would have a dream, and in the dream, God had healed him. And we'd have conversations about that. He goes, do you believe God can do that? And I said, yes, I believe God can heal you. And then oftentimes he'd follow up, he goes, I wish he would. And we had conversations like that several different times. And finally, I asked Brian one day after, like I said, after several conversations about this. I said, Brian, what if he doesn't? What if God, for some reason, doesn't choose to heal you on this side of eternity? We know someday he will. But if he chooses not to heal you on this side of eternity, then what? Brian just continued to walk in faith. Brian just continued to serve. He wanted his life to be a witness to his family and friends. And yes, he has been healed. He is far better off today than he ever has been before. In the very last conversation I had with Brian, we just had an advisory board meeting. And it was just him and I in my office, and we were just talking about various things. And he got up to leave the room, and he had the door halfway open. He turned around and looked at me. And this is what the words I'll never forget. He just simply said this. I guess I'll go home now. And I wondered the day after when we received the phone call, I wonder if Brian knew he was being prophetic. Did he know something that the rest of us didn't know? But we do have the certainty that he is home. and we have a certainty that we will see him again. Brian Harris, 55 of Iola, passed away October 20th, 2021 at home. He was born March 31st, 1966 in Richland Center, son of Leroy and Mildred Pop Harris. Brian graduated from Richland Center High School in 1984. He worked at the pattern shop for 25 years. He married the love of his life, Shelby, on July 28th, 1990. He enjoyed working with his hands, whether it be tinkering, fixing things, or making something for someone. He also enjoyed being outside in nature. He enjoyed everything from hunting to playing with the church league softball and volleyball teams. In his early years, he enjoyed taking long rides with his wife on the motorcycle. He enjoyed being there for his boys and supporting the activities they participated in. He also enjoyed playing euchre. Brian is survived by his wife, Shelby Harris, 31 years, the three sons, Tyler J. and Jamie Day of Navarre, Florida, Zach of Iola, Alex still living at home, grandchildren, Benjamin W. Harris, Aurora Ruth Harris, Amelia Odacker. He's also survived by his siblings, John and Donna Harris, Cheryl and Larry Winger, Alan Harris, Susan Malter, Penny and Kenny Harris, Richard Harris, Amy Harris, Robert and Tammy Harris, Kimberly Hines, Rachel and Jeff Walsh. He's also survived by many nieces and nephews, special friends, Paul and Brenda Mosier, David Ann Trapan, Scott Laura Johnson, Dave and Eileen Gillingham, and Ron Hintz. Would you please join me as we close in prayer? Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. Father, we are thankful for the reason that we know that Brian is with you. That he came to a place in life where he received you as his own. We are thankful, Father, this morning that you are with us. We have the promise of your word that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And we thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit that dwells within us. That the Holy Spirit is our comforter. And so I pray, Father, today for the comfort of the Holy Spirit to be about Shelby, about Tyler and Zach and Alex, about his family today. Father, the days that lie ahead as we continue to process this loss. Father, we don't grieve for Brian because we know where he's at. We know that he's with you. But Father, while we grieve, we ask that you administer to our hearts. Be with us in this process of life. As we continue to be faithful, as we continue to be a witness. And Father, again, we just thank you for your incredible love that you have for us. This incredible love that you have for Shelby and your family. I pray, Father, that you strengthen me from day to day. And I pray, Father, as the days go by and we see things or hear things that remind us of Brian, I pray, Father, that the joy of the Lord would be our strength. Father, that we'd move from grieving to joy. Because we, Father, know that a day is coming when we'll see him again. So we thank you for this day, for many different reasons, for several reasons. And so, Father, again, we just ask that you would bless this time. And I pray, Father, that as we gather in a few moments for a meal, I pray, Father, that you would bless that food to our bodies, give us strength and nourishment. And again, I just ask a blessing over this family today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite you to join the family for a luncheon at the Church of the Nazarene Outreach Center. And I want to say God bless you, and thank you for being with us this afternoon.